On behalf of the Lal Bahadur Shastri Nation Academy of Administration, it is my proud privilege to extend a very warm welcome to Honorable President of India, Shri Ramnath Kovind.
Shri Ramnath Kovind was born on October 1, 1945 in Paronk near Kanpur in Uttar Pradesh. Before assuming charge of the office of the 14th President of India on July 25, 2017, Shri Kovind served as the 36th Governor of the State of Bihar from August 16, 2015 to June 20, 2017. Shri Kovind completed his school education in Kanpur and obtained the degrees of BCom and LLB from Kanpur University. In 1971, he enrolled as an advocate with the Bar Council of Delhi. Shri Kovind was Union Government Advocate in the Delhi High Court from 1977 to 1979 and Union Government Standing Counsel in the Supreme Court from 1980 to 1993. He became Advocate on record of the Supreme Court of India in 1978. He practiced at the Delhi High Court and Supreme Court for 16 years till 1993. Shri Kovind was elected as a member of the Rajya Sabha from Uttar Pradesh in April 1994. He served for two consecutive terms of 6 years each till March 2006. Shri Kovind served on various parliamentary committees like Parliamentary Committee on Welfare of Scheduled Castes, Scheduled Tribes, Parliamentary Committee on Home Affairs, Parliamentary Committee on Petroleum and Natural Gas, Parliamentary Committee on Social Justice and Empowerment, and Parliamentary Committee on Law and Justice. He was chairman of the Rajya Sabha House Committee. An avid reader, Honorable President has keen interest in reading books on politics and social change, law and history and religion. During his long public career, Shri Kovind has traveled widely across the country and internationally. I would like to welcome Secretary to the President of India, Shri Sanjay Kothari, Secretary DOPT, Shri Ajay Mittal, and Director RBSNA Masoori, Shri Upma Tawadri. I would also like to welcome the esteemed officers and staff of the President's Secretariat. Lastly, I would like to welcome the participants of the 119th Induction Training Program coming from different parts of the country. The Induction Training Program started on 3rd of July 2017 and is of 6 weeks duration with 4 weeks of academic inputs at LBSNA Masoori, 1 week of Chris Bharat Darshan, and 1 week of foreign study tour to KDI Seoul, Korea. There are 62 participants in all, with 8 ladies and 54 gentlemen. In all, 12 cadres are represented in this batch. The participants belong to different batches, varying from 2004 to 2015. The course was designed to expose the participants with all the necessary inputs required in order to graduate them to an All India Service Officer. During the four weeks at LBSNA Masoori, they were given inputs on rural development, agriculture, urban development, public-private partnership, health, education, law, foreign policy, economics, Swachh Bharat, GST, Skill India, Make in India, various other social legislations, information and communication technology, soft skills like leadership and negotiations. Efforts were made to make them abreast with all the contemporary concepts of public administration and the policies in place. Speakers from all walks of life were invited to provide them with all-round exposure. As a part of the training, every participant was asked to come prepared with one experience-sharing presentation on any area of public administration. The participants were also given an administration / policy-related problem of which they were asked to prepare a solution. The training curriculum also required the participants to be evaluated on the basis of a midterm examination, their various presentations, and director assessment. The training program also saw a great extent of cultural cohesion among the participants. Coming from different places across the country, they all could interact with each other and understand the nuances of diversity. Various management exercises like negotiation enabled them to understand the various facets of the cultural diaspora of the country. As a part of the mandate to make the trainees healthy and fit, the participants went through a 4-week regimen of physical exercise, including gym, yoga, and sports. After 4 weeks at the academy, they have been on a 1-week domestic study tour, popularly called Bharat Darshan, to different states of the country other than their own cadre. During the Bharat Darshan, the participants had attachment with public sectors, NGOs, urban local bodies, and district administration. The domestic study tour is followed by a two-day stay in Delhi, where the officers call upon Honorable President of India, MOSPP, and the Cabinet Secretary to the Government of India. After these meetings in Delhi, the officers will proceed on a foreign study tour to Seoul, South Korea, where they will have 1 week training with the Korean Development Institute, where they will get exposure to the best practices of Korea in the areas of urban development, education, health, transport management, solid waste management, and economic development. On completion of the foreign study tour, the officers will be relieved by the academy for joining back in their respective cadres on 13th of August 2017. Now, I would like to request few of the officers to share their thoughts on the areas of governance and public administration. I would first request Shri Sunil Chavan and Shri Sanjay Sinha to share their experiences on the best practices.
Honorable President of India, ladies and gentlemen, I am presenting best practice on silent implementation of development plan in Thane city, Maharashtra. In past 2 years, Thane Municipal Corporation has undertaken an ambitious exercise for silent implementation of its development plan, which means a series of planned strategic anti-encroachment drives with the least possible disruption to the public life. Under this drive, over 18,000 illegal constructions and encroachments have been demolished. Rupees 9,000 crore worth of urban land, which has been freed up, covering an area of over 7 lakh square meters. This land is being used for developing tree-laden avenues, model roads, and ultra-modern police chowkis. Rationale behind the program: Thane is referred as a dormitory city, as many residents travel to and from Mumbai for daily work. The roads of the Thane are critical for seamless movement of the traffic within and outside the city. Rapid urbanization and the growth rate of the population has resulted in mushrooming of the illegal constructions and encroachment across the roads, which has led to the traffic congestion, poor connectivity, decreased bus frequency, lack of public spaces and footpaths. We decided to implement the city's development plan by widening the roads through removal of the illegal structures. After several weeks of the diligent assessment and planning, task force was created, which divided itself into area-wise teams and started a phase-wise demolition drive for maximum implementation and minimum inconvenience to the citizens. In order to make sure the law and order was maintained, Police Commissioner Mr. Parambir Singh and the key police officials were taken into confidence. We consulted citizens through ward committees, press releases, press conference to inform and garner support from them. People's representatives were also involved in the decision-making through general body approvals and for new road works. As a social responsibility, corporation formulated a sound policy of rehabilitation to provide basic shelter for the affected households and alternate locations for the commercial establishment. Putting plan into action, which is as follows: more than 16 drives has been conducted in last 2 years. In each drive, Municipal Commissioner Sri Sanjay Jaiswal, additional commissioners, senior officials were present on site to boost the morale of the implementing agencies. Each mission was given an inspiring name, such as Mission Impossible, Operation Fanning, Mission Walkability, to give and boost the morale of the team. Several illegal activities were also honored during these drives, including illegal hookah bars, ladies' dance bars, lodges and restaurants. Wrap-up meeting was conducted daily. A special care was taken to conserve greenery in the city, as well as the old water bodies. Thane is on its way of becoming a well-connected and congestion-free city. The efforts of the Thane Corporation have made the city more walkable, convenient, and pleasant place to live in for its citizens and visitors alike. Thanks and Jai Hind. May I now request Dr. Sanjay Sinha to do his presentation.
Paramadarniya Sradhya Rashtrapati Mahode, उपस्थित विशिष्ट अतिथिगण एवं प्रिय मित्रों, भगवान महावीर, महात्मा बुद्ध एवं गुरु गोविंद सिंह की धरती भारत के कंठहार बिहार के निबंधन विभाग में कंप्यूटराइजेशन से संबंधित मेरा प्रतिवेदन आपके समक्ष समर्पित है। यद्यपि अन्य विकसित राज्यों में पूर्व में यह कार्य प्रारंभ किया गया था, किंतु अन्य राज्यों के मॉडल की अच्छाइयों को आत्मसात कर उसे और भी परिष्कृत ढंग से बिहार राज्य के निबंधन विभाग की व्यवस्था को कंप्यूटरीकृत करने का कार्य वर्ष 2006 में प्रारंभ किया गया। पूर्व में लगभग 200 वर्षों से प्रचलित मैनुअल व्यवस्था, जो समय के साथ अप्रभावी हो गई थी, जिसमें पारदर्शिता का अभाव था, जिसकी गति धीमी थी एवं दस्तावेज प्राप्त करने में निबंधनार्थी जनता को लगभग 7-8 वर्षों का समय लगता था, को समाप्त किया जाना समय की मांग थी। बिहार राज्य के 109 निबंधन कार्यालयों में, जिसमें 38 जिले शामिल थे, में आधारभूत संरचना तैयार करना, विद्युत आपूर्ति सुनिश्चित करना एक बहुत बड़ी चुनौती थी। पायलट प्रोजेक्ट मुजफ्फरपुर मॉडल से कार्य प्रारंभ किया गया। NIC के द्वारा तैयार किए गए सॉफ्टवेयर एवं जिसे विनायक एक का नाम दिया गया था, एवं हार्डवेयर की व्यवस्था आउटसोर्स की गई। प्रति पृष्ठ 20 रुपये निबंधनार्थी जनता से लिए जाने का प्रावधान किया गया, एवं पायलट प्रोजेक्ट की सफलता के बाद रिकॉर्ड 5 महीने के समय में संपूर्ण राज्य के सभी निबंधन कार्यालयों को कंप्यूटरीकृत कर एक कीर्तिमान स्थापित किया गया। इस पूरी प्रक्रिया की सबसे बड़ी विशेषता यह है कि इसमें राज्य सरकार पर कोई वित्तीय भार नहीं आया और सफलतापूर्वक पूरे राज्य में इसे लागू किया गया। ई गवर्नेंस की व्यवस्था राष्ट्रीय एवं राज्य स्तर पर सुनिश्चित किया जाना आज सभी सरकारों की प्राथमिकता सूची में सबसे ऊपर आता है। निबंधन विभाग के प्रयास, पदाधिकारियों एवं कर्मचारियों की कड़ी मेहनत, कार्य के प्रति निष्ठा एवं अल्प समय में जनता से प्राप्त किया गया विश्वास का परिणाम यह हुआ कि वर्ष 2007-08 के प्राइम मिनिस्टर एक्सीलेंस इन पब्लिक सर्विस सम्मान से इस प्रोजेक्ट को पुरस्कृत किया गया। किंतु यह विराम या विश्राम नहीं था, यह तो आगाज़ था उस कंप्यूटर क्रांति का, जिसके रथ पर सवार होकर राज्य की कंप्यूटरीकृत निबंधन व्यवस्था प्रत्येक दिवस एक नया कीर्तिमान स्थापित कर रही थी। आधुनिक जन सुविधाओं का विकास, राज्य स्तरीय केंद्रीकृत सर्वर का विकास, 200 वर्ष पुराने अभिलेखों का डिजिटाइजेशन, ऑनलाइन के माध्यम से लगातार जनमानस के बीच अपनी विश्वसनीयता बढ़ाने में विभाग सक्षम हो सका था। आज संपूर्ण राष्ट्र में बिहार ऐसा प्रथम राज्य बन गया है जो निबंधन के बाद 15 से 20 मिनटों के अंदर दस्तावेजों का परिदान कर उसी कार्य दिवस में पब्लिक डोमेन में दस्तावेजों को प्रदर्शित करने में सक्षम है। बुलंदियों पर पहुंचना कमाल नहीं, बुलंदियों पर ठहरना कमाल है, और इस दृष्टिकोण से हमने बिहार के राज्यपाल के रूप में आपके ऐतिहासिक कार्यकाल में स्थापित किए गए कीर्तिमानों को आगे बढ़ाने का कार्य किया है। धन्यवाद। जय हिंद।
द ऑनरेबल प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, एट द आउटसेट ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ दिस 119th बैच ऑफ इंडक्शन ट्रेनिंग आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट ऑनरेबल सर ऑन बिकमिंग द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ दिस ग्रेट नेशन। On the 26th November 1949, we enacted the constitution and the policies were framed and implemented accordingly. But today's world is more dynamic. In the words of Thomas Friedman, the world is flat, where each country is striving hard to become the world leader. On the inception of the new government, Honorable Prime Minister assumed office with citizen first as a motto, and things started changing dramatically. Today, an unprecedented urge is seen among the people to transform India into a developed nation. To meet this expectation, a lot of business process re-engineering is being done. The self-certification of documents has relieved lakhs of citizens from queuing before notaries and magistrate just to speak the truth on oath. Getting public service is no longer a favor, but has become a matter of right. We have done many things, still much more is yet to be done. The educated, healthy, and self-dependent citizens are the real asset of the nation. Therefore, the core areas like education, health, employability need to be given even more priority. About education, during our Bharat Darshan tour in Orissa, we saw phenomenal work of Kalinga Institute of Social Science, which educates and skills over 25,000 tribal students. This self-financing cross-subsidy model has sure answers to the problem of insufficiency of resources in the field of education. In health sector, government has a network and private sector has resources and expertise. If they both meet, we can deliver the best medical facilities in the area where those are most needed. Employability is very important, as empty minds is devil's workshop. Though there is no direct connect of education with employability, unfortunately, mark sheets decide the fate of the job seekers. If we could formally recognize the real life talent, not on the basis of mark sheet, but on the basis of worksheet, we will get master of works than mere bachelors of degrees. Then the job seekers may become job givers. Thus, when all these core things are set right, these disparities in income and opportunities will wither away, and the last man can pluck the fruits of progress at his own. To achieve this, administration as a delivery engine is running to its fullest capacity, and there is an immense need of showing more trust in it and appreciating its distinct quality of neutrality and adherence to the rule of law. There is need to reassure that the wrong will be punished, but every good will be recognized, awarded, and protected also. Honorable Sir, today we all officers from different states Assure your good self that we are committed to change India into a global leader, and that day is not far away. Jai Hind. Now I request my colleague Vimla to speak.
The Honorable President of India, ladies and gentlemen, I'll be speaking on good governance and its facilitation. On assuming office, the Honorable Prime Minister hit a new ground with the clarion, minimum government, maximum governance. His 10 governance priorities include proactive, people-oriented government and governance, putting people at the center of development, better service delivery, accountability, better decision-making, outcomes, efficient use of resources are words we hear often. The government and public sector are substantial employers and capital market participants, and their expenditure is significant to the GDP. Their outcomes are achieved through legislation, delivering goods and services, taxation, and social security schemes. Governments also have a role in promoting peace and order, international relations. The real challenge and concern, however, is implementation. The following could be done to facilitate governance. Creation of a governing body for providing strategic direction to reassure individuals of protection from any potential negative repercussions. Accountability, as the government has an obligation to report, explain, and be answerable for the consequences of the decisions it has made. Making people a part of the decision-making process so that they understand how and why a decision was made, and they value and take care of the infrastructure developed for them. Whistleblowers also need a policy and legislation for protection to ensure transparency. Systems to review individual performances also already exist, but non-compliance needs to be monitored with a code. Uniform, robust procurement policy, ensuring contractors and all associated with contracts acknowledge their ethical responsibility in delivering public services. Evaluation of expenditures against milestones and deliverables. Monitoring mechanisms to provide regular reports on progress and outcomes with key performance indicators. Resources, as we all know, are limited. A system of feedback from citizens to prioritize demands within the available resources. Changes in policy and law are constant. Continuous training for upgrading the skills and knowledge of officials. Effective use of IT and social media and reporting to reach out to the stakeholders. External audit by qualified professionals for analytical review, systems evaluation and compliance. And of course, convergence of all departments so that they do not work in silos. Development is the focus of the times today, and practice, not theory, should be the mantra for good governance. Jai Hind.
Honorable President of India, ladies and gentlemen, I'm speaking on ways in which to apply training to workplace. I wholeheartedly thank the competent faculties of this wonderful capacity building institution who made the interactive learning an interesting and valuable one, and the module of training on various skills in leadership, GST, challenges of public procurement, including negotiation, government e-market, and Startup India, Digital India, all which has been designed keeping in mind the latest development and changes sweeping across the nation. During training, I am informed about how to convert the villages into ODF-free villages through community-led sanitation campaign and a Swachh Bharat mission. I thoroughly enjoy the vibrant campus life, best of infrastructure facilities, with sight glimpses of Missouri, and imparting of requires professional competence, skills, and attitudes necessary for fine-tuning the public administration to cater to the public needs and address the various type of issues that crop up in the course of discharging the public duties. It would not be an exaggeration to say that this unique academy blends theory and practice by affording the opportunity to the trainees to deliberate on challenges and opportunities for good governance, improving public policy formulation, public services delivery, upgrade professional skill. Indeed, I marvel at the distinguished alumni comprising of experts from the various fields who, right from the day one of the training, worked with unflinching commitment and absolute dedication. While the training curriculum is extensive and need-based, the pedagogy is equally diverse and interactive. No doubt, the training imparted here will definitely transform the trainees into an effective, efficient, responsive, and accountable civil servants characterized by integrity in thought and action. The rigorous physical exercise and extracurricular activities keep our mind body fit for often tension-filled career back in our home state. With this, I would like to extend my thanks for this opportunity, which I will cherish in my heart forever. And I assure you that the training I have undergone will stand everyone in good stead while facing so many challenges and to serve the people in a better way. Thank you. Jai Hind. Now I request my colleague Bhupendra Singh to share his views.
I'll speak on the application of this training at workplace. This training has helped us to understand the principles of economics, sociology, law, management, policy analysis and design, project appraisals, etc. We could improve our soft skills by working in groups and develop effective leadership traits through various management games and tools. We were also exposed to various issues which are relevant today, like ethics in governance, gender issues, and the challenges in the education and health sector which we are facing today. The trainees also worked in groups to solve the given problems and made presentations about the solutions suggested by them. The officers also shared the information regarding the best practices in various fields in different states, both in the class and in informal discussions. We feel that we are now better equipped with both quantitative and qualitative skills to analyze the problems and develop effective solutions to them. The learnings on negotiation, leadership, project appraisal, procurement, and implementation of PPP projects would be of immense help in performance of our duties. Honorable President, we are keenly looking forward to apply the learnings in our job situations after we return to our respective states. Thanks. Jai Hind.
Sri Ajay Mittal ji, Secretary Department of Personnel and Training. Ms. Upma Chaudhary ji, Director Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration, Mussoorie. Sri Mansoor Hasan Khan, Course Coordinator, 119th Induction Training Program. Distinguished guests, officer trainees attending 119th Induction Training Program, ladies and gentlemen. It is really a pleasure for me to be amongst you today. I welcome you to Rashtrapati Bhavan and congratulate you on your selection to the IAS. At independence, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, our first Home Minister, realized that India could not be integrated and governed unless it had an efficient and professional All India Civil Service. This civil service needed to have the necessary job security and safeguards to allow it to offer independent advice to the political executive. The All India Services have played a significant role in the development of the country and the growth of our economy. Even so, we have to be mindful of the expectations of our young population and of the poor and marginalized sections of our society. We cannot ignore that there are often legitimate questions that are asked about the quality of our governance systems and our bureaucratic mechanism. Sometimes these perceptions may be more adverse than reality warrants, but perceptions do matter. There is also a perception that over time, certain officers get identified with one or the other political dispensation or individual. You must guard against this. The most important challenge before you is to give confidence to the people of India. That is the people you are mandated to serve. That civil servants are fair, honest, professional, and efficient. As public servants, you need to be role models in your personal conduct. In your professional conduct, honesty and integrity, humility and sensitivity to the diversity of India and of our society are non-negotiable. A question that you need to ask yourself is, whom do you really work for? The usual answer would be that you work for the people of India. But there are people who need the government and who need your support and services more than the others. These are our fellow citizens who are economically weak, socially disadvantaged, and politically under-empowered, or those who are treated with a disadvantage only because they are women. It is on these groups that you must focus your energies. Here it is useful to keep in mind Gandhiji's mantra, quote, "Whenever in doubt, recall the face of the poorest and the weakest man you have seen and ask yourself if the step you contemplate is going to be of any use to him," unquote. Let this be your guiding light. The civil services have to function within the larger system of political governance. Political leaders are elected to represent the wishes of the people in a democracy and frame the agenda of the government. Civil servants are to assist the political executive in formulation and in implementation of policy. They must ensure that government policies are formulated in accordance with the law and the spirit of the Constitution. Civil servants must have the courage to provide frank advice, independent and free from bias, to the political executive whom they assist. For this, officers need to encourage professionalism, not only in their own working, but also in the organizations they lead. They need to be strongly committed to updating their knowledge and skills, as well as building capacity of those who work under them. The induction training program is an important milestone as you enter a new phase in your careers. The wider role you will now play in the governance and the administration of India calls for realignment of attitudes, refinement of skills, and expansion of perspective. There should be an even greater commitment to rising above caste, community, and regional identities. Wherever you may work, irrespective of the district or the state, the ministry or the department, you will be contributing to nation building. The course at the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration is aimed at providing an all-India perspective. It is planned to develop a sense of awareness and responsibility for working at the next level in the state and union governments through. Imparting multidisciplinary knowledge and skills to function effectively as an administrator. Number two, instilling the right attitude and approach to understanding the role of the IAS in developing institutions for nation building. And number three, inculcating a sense of camaraderie and connect with your peers from other parts of the country. I trust the course has been able to achieve its objectives and enhance your skills in the important role you are going to play in the governance of the country. I wish you a long and fulfilling career in the IAS and in the service of our nation and of our people. God bless you. Thank you. Jai Hind.